Right, let's go through this. BBC Model B video. You can see UHF, composite and RGB. There's S video here. Yes, I know it doesn't come with S video. We're actually going to add an S video output to it. That's what this video is going to be about. Now, you'll know that over the last few months I've actually wasted quite a bit of money in the goals of getting the BBC hooked up to a monitor via DVI and also a TV via HDMI, because I view those as being the only true future-proof connections at the moment. UHF is pretty much out the window. First off, it's a crap signal, and secondly, it's because analog UHF is being switched off in the UK. It should be finished switching off in 2012, after which I don't think we'll find any new TVs with analog UHF connections. So, that's on its way out. We have, of course, composite, which is a relatively cheap connection to the TV, so long as you can get a bayonet connector at one end, a cable for a couple of quid should sort you out. The problem is that it's only a luminance, which basically means it's monochromatic, black and white. You can, if you've got an issue 407 motherboard, make a connection of S39, which is on the motherboard, quite next to the UHF unit, and that will add the chrominance signal to the luminance to give you a colour signal over composite. But the one problem with that is that you'll wind up, it doesn't mix very well, so you'll wind up with a bit of a wavy signal. That will typically go to a TV. Very few monitors have a composite input on them. RGB, being a one-bit digital, is somewhat difficult, but I have found that connecting it via SCART to some of the modern flat-screen TVs does have a degree of success. That can be achieved for only a few quid and a bit of soldering work. There is already a video in this channel that shows me doing that. So if you want to try that, there you go. A few quid's worth of parts. Possibly about 10 to 15 quid's worth. But this video is going to be about S video. The S video is basically taking the composite signal and also sending the chrominance signal separately. So we have the negative across those two pins, the luminance across one, and the chrominance across the other, and we're letting the receiving technology do the mixing. As the BBC is basically 30-year-old hardware, if we're letting modern equipment do it, it can do a better job of it. So you can typically use a cheap VGA converter, S video to VGA, to drive a monitor, but this is only via VGA. So we've got SCART connections, composite connections and VGA connections. We're still short here of the targets of DVI and HDMI, but this should see us forward for a few years yet. There is some more technology that's being worked on to convert RGB direct to VGA, which will give us the best signal possible to a monitor. That's still being worked on by Retro Clinic. There are timing issues, but it's under development. And hopefully, once Retro Clinic gets that sorted, it should only be an output format jump to get it to go to DVI and HDMI. The big thing seems to be decoding the RGB signal and getting the timing right to pull that out. But there's two ways of handling this, to handling the S video, and that is, one is if you're willing to say goodbye to composite, to getting colour through composite, then you can just wire this up relatively simply. If you want to have the option of S video or having colour on composite, then you're going to have to add a little switch in. And that's what this video is going to be about. is going to be about making this and putting the S-video connection in and the switch and making the wiring. Right, sorry for this being handheld, but there you go. What we're doing is installing these S-video sockets into the BBC and also installing a switch at the same time. Now these came from Euro Network Limited. euronetwork.co.uk, and you're looking for product code 11-1049. That's 11-1049. Socket S-video 4-pin mini DIN solder chassis mount. Now what I've done here is how we're going to wire this is, you can see the composite that we've got there. That's the standard composite. We're going to take two wires from there, and we've got the traditional S39. I don't know if you can see down there the traditional pins that you would cross if you wanted the composite to be colour. And what I'm doing is putting a standard jack on there, plug, which you can easily rescue from a PC. This cabling will go over here to this switch. S39 will go to this switch when it's in the right hand position, to mean I'm taking right hand to mean composite. This will be closed, so the connection between the two wires will be made and the colour will come out of the composite as usual. When it goes to the left, that'll mean S video, which is the socket over here, and the connection will break. And we're going to wire this up on the S video here, and that'll be pretty much it. We'll get an S video signal out. Now, in order to do these holes, the socket itself had to be put in. It wasn't deep enough for a start for the nut to work, so it had to be super glued into position. I've used a number 12 wood bit to get out, to get in there, because the bit that I needed was too big to fit the chuck. And also, once I had done it, the usual countersink was too small to handle it. So what I've had to do is just use some super glue and super glue that into position. Not easy, but there you go. And obviously the switch was put in with a standard 7mm bit. I keep calling it 4mm for some reason, but it's 7mm. So there you have it. I've installed these two physically into the machine. We've got the cabling to do it. What I'm going to do, probably to run that cable behind there, is I'm going to leave myself enough so I can disconnect that easily if I need to take the motherboard out. Then I'm probably going to have to use something like insulating tape to stick it to the back. I would have liked to have used some sort of cable clip, but I haven't got any. So what I'm going to do in part two is to show you how to wire this in. And then we're going to also have a discussion as to is there any benefit to doing this. So, yeah, oh brother, see you in a bit. S-video port, take 78. This is a view of the back end of the S-video port as it should be inside the BBC. Well, let's take a look at the machine. And here we have it. Here we have two sections, one black and red containing the composite. The red contains the signal, and another black and red containing the S39, I think it is. And they both go over here. Now, the black and the red that are connected to the composite port go straight to the back of the S-video port. And those are, the black goes across the bottom two connectors. The red, which carries the composite signal, goes to the top left. The top right goes via a 1 kilo ohm resistor to this switch. That switch, if it's in the leftmost position, actually breaks the connection between the black and the red. In the rightmost position, it makes the connection between the black and the red. So what that does is, with the switch in the right position, the black and the red are connected, and it is as if you're using the composite port with the colour added. In the leftmost position, only the red is connected via the resistor to the top right hand port of the S-Video. So that's how I've enabled myself to use the S-Video and also switch it to color composite if I want to. So I've retained the choice. And that's it in action. So have there been any cock-ups with this? Well, yes, there was a big mistake. This is one of the machines, and pretty much I do everything on here first before I do it on the other one, and I learned a few lessons. One was the positioning of the switch. Putting it above the analog port like that makes it very difficult to take the machine out. The second is actually the wiring of the S-Video port itself. The principal thing should be to actually solder the wires onto it before mounting it in the case. I didn't think, I was so busy concentrating on actually getting the mounting that I completely forgot about the wiring. So yeah, definitely wire it up before you put it in the case. As for the resistor, well, if I move the switch, then the position between the resistor and the port is going to be different, probably longer. I'll probably put it to the right of the analog port here, which means I'm going to have to change the position of the resistor. I'll probably put it, put a wire in there and take that back as well. I wanted to use some cable clips, but mine are just too large and again they interfere. So I've just used black tape to keep everything nice and reasonably tidy. And that's about it for the bloopers. Here is the converter in question. You can probably find it on eBay for about £15 from China, and it comes with its own power supply. The power supply has another issue, we'll come to that in a moment. But it outputs VGA to a monitor, and it also inputs from a number of sources. You will find that it converts from composite as well, but the problem is that the signal is terrible. So it's best to use the S-Video to input, and you've got a few options that can allow you to control the resolution. You've got a menu for various options, sharpness and things. You've also got a freeze button, so you can actually freeze the video, you can freeze the frame, and while the BBC is actually carrying on displaying. So that's it's pretty much the best solution for the money that's out there for the moment. The one problem with that cheap system is this: it's a very cheap power supply and it's very noisy. That will feed back through the S-Video line and will upset the BBC. You'll get loads of noise. So what we're going to do is we're going to cut in between the line relatively close to the power supply itself, and we're going to make an in and an out. We're going to use these tracks, put the positive and negative there, the other positive and negative there, and throughout this we're going to put some capacitors. The voltage is 5 volts, so the capacitors we're using need to be, let's say, 8 volts and above. We're starting with a 2200 microfarad. That's rated at 10 volts, so that should be fine. We have, we're going to be using two 1000 microfarads. They're at 25 volts, those are well safe. And 1000 nanofarads, and those are rated at 50 volts. Now, the microfarads are actually polarized, so you've got to watch which way around you're putting them. As you can see, we've got a negative here. One side is showing with a negative symbol, and that will match the negative feed from here. Fortunately, if you look at this, it tells you that positive is in the center, so we know what we're doing. So I'm going to mount on that side of the board. Pins are going to come through and they're going to be soldered to this side of the board. Here roughly is the finished product. We have the board with the capacitors mounted on top of it. This is the 2200 microfarad capacitor. The positive is actually coming to the track here. The negatives are on the other side, and you can see basically what's done. The strips are going through, and these are just connected in line. So if you took all the capacitors off It would effectively be a straight through connection for the positive and a straight through connection for the negative. But these are basically there to smooth things out, and it's mounted quite close to the power supply, because this is basically a switch mode power supply. It's not an actual transformer. An actual transformer like this is a bit more weighty, and it costs a bit more. Transformers do cost a bit more than switch modes. Now it's just a matter of getting an appropriate box, drilling the right holes, and mounting that in the box safely. So once I've done that, I can sort that out, put the lid on, and that is the power supply sorted. Now the economics for doing this vary. Oh, what can I say? If you're going to be doing two or more of these, then the actual cost of the capacitors and getting hold of those and shipped to you isn't, and the board also isn't too bad. But if you're only going to use one, then you're probably better off investing in a decent transformer and using that instead. So just read off what the switch mode power supply is giving out. In this case, its output is 5 volts at 2 amps, and you need 5 volts at an amperage that's not less than 2. This one here is actually throwing out, this one's throwing out 5 volts DC at 3 amps, so that's plenty. That's all, and once you've got the power supply sorted out, that's it, you're good to go. So there you have it. Adding an S video port to a BBC isn't a great deal of hassle. It just takes a bit of patience. And with that cheap S video to VGA converter, that should be a reasonable cost way of getting it hooked up to a VGA monitor. Of course, how we'd manage to convert that up to DVI, I'm not 100% sure at the moment. So, well, even though we're still short of the golden goal of getting it hooked up to DVI and HDMI, we're still getting our way there. So, I hope that solution should help you avoid the kind of idiot money that I've forked out over the last few months to try and get this working. Incidentally, big thanks to Stardot, as usual, and also Retro Clinic. My friend Calcat, as always, and who else has been involved in this? I think that's the main body of people thanked for that one. So that's how you get around it. Cheers.